Welcome to the Cult Classic Horror Show. Every week, you can have the conversations you've always wanted to have about the films you love.
Shut up!
Get rid of your distractions and prepare yourself.
You got a big surprise coming to you. You're not going anywhere.
Welcome everybody to the Cult Classic Horror Show. Danny Bonin here with you.
And Scotty Bonin here with you as well.
We are
the Blood Brothers.
Once again, we have our awesome guest, Rob O'Neill. Rob.
Hey guys, and just like your first erection in freshman year of high school, I just pop up unannounced.
That's right, baby.
Whether you like it or not.
And hopefully you're not wearing gym shorts.
Yeah.
Yeah, and usually like in math class.
Yeah.
When you got to go up and write something on the board.
I'm just gonna adjust you right under my belt.
Yeah. You have to make sure there's an extra belt loop so you can tighten your belt. Just put it up there.
Just flip it up into your belly button.
Yeah.
That's and then
it in there.
Hope that your shirt doesn't pop up and someone catches a glimpse of a little mushroom head.
Yep. Yep, that's no good. Well, yeah, man, it's good to have you back on, Rob. Always a pleasure, and like like we always say, you're like one of us. So it's routine now.
We're finishing out Exorcist with you. So, and maybe beyond, we'll see what our schedules look like. So
there's always beyond. I'll tell you one thing.
I'm
coming at y'all live but recorded from Baton Rouge, and I had to pack my laptop and my extra monitor and my audio equipment, so I only brought one pair of underwear with me. That's how committed I am.
Dude, that is
commitment. And how many days are you there?
Five.
All right. Yeah, that's doable.
And it's sweaty. It's balmy. It's 90-something degrees outside. I just wring it out into a mason jar that I'm slowly filling up to express mail to Colorado.
Oh, yeah. Oh, thank you.
I can't wait. I can't wait to just set that out in the living room and let it fumigate, you know?
It's a housewarming present. You could put like cinnamon sticks or whatever in it and let it sit there and just,
okay.
You know, in the living room. It'll be a discussion piece.
Yeah.
And then when it rots out, you just pour it in a glass of water with ice and drink it.
Exactly. It ages like fine wine.
Yeah, exactly. or like a single malt scotch. There we go.
I'll be surprised if your underpants exist after this trip.
We're about to see if the Under Armours are worth $25 a pair.
That's true.
They better be, damn it, for God's sakes.
All right, well, here we are, Exorcist the Beginning.
Ooh, yes. 2005.
Scotty does that a lot. I'll say something, he'll go, ooh.
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 You paid for your whole seat, but you're only going to need the edge.
Ooh.
More sangria? Ooh.
So this was a good movie. I remember watching this in theaters.
Yep.
And I mean it didn't get very good reviews, and William Peter Blatty is quoted as hating it, but I liked it. I thought it was good.
I liked it too. I mean, it didn't get good reviews because of the director.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody's trying to hate on Renny Harlin, that beautiful whatever he is, like he's Dutch.
Yeah. So yeah, Renny Harlin directed. He's also directed like Cliffhanger, Die Hard 2, Deep Blue Sea. He did a Nightmare on Elm Street 4, The Dream Master too.
Oh yeah.
And of course he did Cutthroat Island.
Cutthroat Island. I haven't even seen that movie.
I've never seen that either.
Don't see it.
Don't recommend
It's like one of the worst movies of all. I think he's been nominated for like 6 worst director awards.
Well, he was for this one.
Which I don't understand.
I don't either.
Were they expecting to win an Oscar?
Yeah, no.
I mean, it made its money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I thought it, I think it's good because they set out to not just reenact the first one. In the commentary we listened to, Renny says, he's like, you know, we can't just make another movie where someone is being exorcised for an hour and a half and they're tied to a bed. You know, it's just, it'll be bullshit. We have to go somewhere else with this film. And I thought where they took it was fine. It was great.
Yeah, they took it back to square one, and as he was saying, kind of gave that Indiana Jones feel. But I thought it was its own movie, and as it sits, and I was entertained for sure. But you know, you have to go somewhere outside of Georgetown, Washington, and into, you know, Africa where it was based. Of course, they shot mostly all of it in Rome, but yeah, I don't understand why the critics gave it bad reviews.
Yeah, I don't either. I mean, you know, especially he did take it, I think, in a good direction, because Renny Harlin is not subtle. And all the other Exorcist movies have been kind of subtle, but this was like an action movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And let's get this out of the way. You know, we are going to do an episode on Dominion next week before we get into Halloween for Halloween. But it really, they started out wanting to do Dominion. I forgot who distributed. Morgan Creek started out with Paul Schrader, who is the director for Dominion. And they may have even started doing some filming from what I read, and then decided to fire him because they didn't like the script. It was a psychological thriller, mm-hmm. and they wanted more, yeah, less subtlety, more blood and gore, more upfront violence and action. So they scrapped him. They went with Renny Harlin. Renny Harlin sort of redid the screenplay, recast a couple parts, kept some of the same people, and had to reshoot some scenes and redo a lot of things. But and then eventually after this released and didn't, I guess, get the reviews or do quite as well as Morgan Creek wanted, then they went ahead and released Dominion right after it anyways, again, with Paul Schrader directing.
Mm-hmm. And they brought Paul Schrader back. Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of weird.
Yeah, yeah, and the crazy part is it really all started off, they wanted John Frankenheimer to do it, but he backed out for health reasons and he died a month later.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I didn't mean that.
Yeah, and of course, Frankenheimer was the one that directed The Island of Dr. Moreau, which absolutely just tanked.
Yeah,
they went through a lot of people, but I think I liked it. I saw this in theaters too, and yeah, as soon as it came out on DVD, I bought it.
Yeah, yeah. Us too.
Yeah, I got it. I got it on DVD too. This is how classic mine is. Mine is it's in a Blockbuster box because I think I just kept it. it's not the Blockbuster box that's like white and blue with the Blockbuster yellow on it. It's the actual cover, you know, of the movie. Like they started doing that later on where they actually would give you the cover of the movie. And I think just in case you kept it, and then and that was their thing towards the end. They're like, you can rent it, like it's this much if it's this late, it's this much if it's this late, and if you just keep it, then it's this much, you know. And so I just kept it.
I got a ton of DVDs in my house still from where they closed down Blockbuster, and you go in there and buy them for like $3 each.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
I have like Critters and a whole bunch of sorry stuff.
Hey, those movies are classics, man.
Yeah.
But they're $3, you know. You got to buy them. You got to buy them.
So,
but no, I like the movie. I like the beginning of it. I think the movie really catches you. Like, as soon as you start to watch it, it's like, oh, okay, this is something cool. This is something different. Like you said, it's not in Georgetown.
Yeah.
It's really neat, especially with the, you know, it starts off with the Middle Ages, 5 BC or whatever, but the whole thing takes place like in 1947, and it gives it a cool Indiana Jones old school vibe that in like 2004-2005 there wasn't anything out like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what's cool is you have to like think of it, this is before the 1973 one. So we have Stellan Skarsgård that's playing Father Marin. That's the younger Father Marin, you know, and eventually in 73, he turns into Max von Sydow, and all of that little Pazuzu head is it travels from this movie to the 1973 movie. It gets buried in the sand, and he finds it 30 years later, you know.
Unfortunately, it makes a stop in Exorcist 2, The Heretic.
Yeah. But it's kind of...
Pazuzu was like, I'm getting the fuck out of here.
Yeah. But I like how it kind of went back, you know, like it's before the 1973 one, even though the 73 one is so much older. I thought they followed the storyline pretty well, you know, connecting it to the 1973 Exorcist.
And there was a note saying, and it didn't connect at all to Exorcist 2 Heretic. I'm like, well, no one in the entire franchise wanted to connect to Exorcist 2 Heretic.
Why the hell would that even be a possibility? Oh, man. But yeah, and then even following, I guess Father Marin was really the only actual character that was in it that could relate to the other ones.
Yeah.
But it was cool how that story followed.
I mean,
that.
We could sort of, we watched, my version has commentary. We got a lot of cool stuff from that. We looked up some stuff online, but we could sort of walk through some of the movie, and I got a lot of notes written down, and Rob can provide his commentary.
Yeah, and some of the stuff that you found, too.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't find too much because I think Dominion's going to be even, you know, crazier with all the behind the scenes and what happened. But Stellan Skarsgård did get eaten by a shark in Deep Blue Sea. So
that's true.
Hey, we know that now. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I'm actually excited to check out Dominion this coming week for our next episode. Yeah, I've never seen it, and it's basically was made alongside this movie. But as I've read, and we'll see if it's true, it's a little bit more of a psychological thriller. So maybe it's comparative to Exorcist 3 as opposed to like maybe the blood and gore of Exorcist 1, you know? So we'll see. I don't know.
Yeah.
But
yeah, no, I'm the same. I'm not seeing Dominion, but I think I'm actually just going to watch it tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah. Heck yeah. I can't wait to see
it. So this... as Scotty already mentioned, this was pretty much all filmed in Rome. And most, actually 90% of it, or maybe 80% of it, was filmed in a studio in Rome. And I forgot the name of it. It's got a hard to pronounce Roman name, but it's a famous studio where tons of movies are shot.
It was like Cinella Chitar or something.
Yeah, but
that's what it was called.
So yeah, I mean, it's really amazing. I mean, obviously there are some parts in this movie that are obviously CGI, like the hyenas are CGI, all the flies in the movie are CGI,
mm-hmm.
Just a lot of it. And the flies aren't as obvious, but definitely the hyenas are, for sure.
And some of the backgrounds of like the back lot that they filmed in.
So that's what I'm getting at, is that it's just amazing when we're watching it and he tells you, oh, that's a CGI backdrop, that's a matte painting. So for instance, you know, even when we come in to the opening city, the pyramids and the whole city, right in that first scene where they're all in like a downtown marketplace area, that whole thing, the alleyway is there. It's a built set on studio property. But then everything in the background, the rest of the city, the pyramids, that's all a matte painting. So someone painted that, and it's just sitting in the background. And what Harlin talks about, how he wanted to have this open up in sort of that marketplace scene so that it was similar to the opening of The Exorcist, but wanted to just make it a little different. So it doesn't look exactly the same, but there are some of the same elements, some of the same people working in the background and things like that.
He was saying that he wanted to kind of stay away from the CGI aspect, but with time and money, there wasn't enough time, there wasn't enough money for the budget, so he wanted to make it as real as possible, but just couldn't because, you know, they had to wrap it up.
At the time, he said this is probably the lowest budget he had ever worked with.
Yeah,
so.
Which was $50 million or something.
Yeah, estimated budget was like $50 million for this or something.
So
it was like $80 million, but they spent $30 million on a Schrader's version. And then by the time they came in, you know, that was another thing too, that kind of like doesn't give him Renny a fair shake really, is, you know, he didn't get to start this from scratch.
Yeah.
He had to come in with what he had, and that's cool with the mat and stuff like that. And he did try to play it off as real as he could, but you know, Morgan Creek, everybody was, breathing down his throat, I'm sure, saying, we need this out now, and this is what you have to work with. Yep. Just do it.
Yeah.
So they, Vittorio Storaro was the cinematographer, and apparently he's like a huge legend. Mm-hmm. I should have looked up what else he's done, but Renny Harlin couldn't say enough about him. So once I had that in my head, I did start to notice that there were some pretty cool cinematographic effects. I don't know how the fuck you'd say
cinematographic
that.
Effects.
Cinematographic.
He did the shit real good.
Yeah exactly. There we go. He did the shit good.
He even snuck in a little Dutch angle, which is that crooked angle, and it's when Father Marin is at the doorway of God somewhere. Mm-hmm. But it reminds me of Evil Dead, because that's what Sam Raimi does, Dutch angles all the time.
Yeah, that was really cool. But he was like, Vittorio or whatever was like praising Harlin, like, hey, you're the one director. I'm not going to take any orders but from you. So that was cool that they kind of meshed together.
He was very specific about saying, I'm not the director of photography. I'm the cinematographer, because there's only one director, and that's you. And
that's right.
You run the show. So very humble guy. But, we talked about it being filmed in Rome. So some of the exterior shots were shot outside of the studio. But anytime you see them driving... for instance, in the very beginning, when they're driving to the dig, they're driving out of the dig. A lot of it is either stock footage that they've bought from, you know, expeditions in Africa or documentaries. Or they did use a gravel pit in Rome for filming, where a couple times he's driving out of the dig or back into it or driving around, they've just sort of used a spot in the gravel pit to film that.
Like the back lot. Yeah.
But no,
which I think is really cool, because watching the movie, it seems like, at least to me, some things are CGI, but I think they did a really good job of covering it up. It looked like they were on site. I thought they did a really good job.
No, it's true. And you know, what else was in the studio? So some of those driving was an actual gravel pit, like, out there. But then, built on the studio site was, like, the church dig, where you see the top of the church, and the church becomes more visible, more visible, more visible. Harlin says, you know, that was in a sort of a U-shaped lot out back of the studio, fiberglass enclosed lot, about a little bit bigger than a tennis court. So,
wow.
Yeah. So you had this church that keeps getting bigger and bigger. And a lot of the other shots, they called it the toilet bowl, because it would rain and it would be muddy in there. And it was all dirt and mud. And so it donned the nickname the toilet bowl. We're shooting in the toilet bowl today.
But the producers didn't like that.
It always gets you primed up.
Yeah. Yeah.
The toilet bowl. Let's go film the toilet bowl.
Yeah, so it was amazing what they did with that space. I mean, there were portions where they're just talking to Father Mariner. They're filming him walking around, and Harlin would just say, oh, this is that's a CGI background. Usually you'd be seeing streetlights and buildings in the background, you know. So you have to think for the actors what that's like to be in African garb, digging in this fake like pit in the back lot of the studio. And if you look over your shoulder, you see streetlights and buildings and things like that.
Yeah. And in the movie, you see extended.
Yeah, and the director's terrain. Like, "Don't worry, I swear to God, you're not. It's gonna look like a big old mountain range in the background."
Yeah. Which looked pretty good. Yeah, I thought it looked pretty good.
No, I thought the movie was on site somewhere in the middle of nowhere. But I mean, you got to have some kind of a vision, just even to be an extra or something like this. This shit isn't gonna work.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. Oh my God. Yeah.
It's true. It's true. So, but you know what he talked about too, in this filming style, and why Vittorio did such a good job too, is that there's so many, and this has to do with the budget too. There's so many cuts in the film language has changed so much between The Exorcist 1973 and this 2004 version of the beginning. Back in 1973, you know, that movie might have 1,000 cuts in it, meaning, you know, it's on one person, the camera switches to another person. It's just 1,000 cuts, different where it's cutting back and forth. Whereas this movie today, I mean, I say today, but this is 2004.
Five.
2005 had over two to 3,000 cuts in it. And it's just, so what Renny Harlin was saying is that maybe people of today watching The Exorcist for the first time, the 1973 version, they might think it's starting out a little slow or it drags on a little bit or they spend too much time in character development. And so thing that Harlin was struggling with was, where do we start bringing in the scares? Where do we start? How long can we build these characters up and keep the audience's attention? So it has to do with putting all those cuts in. It has to do with not waiting too long to put these scares in. And you'll notice they sort of first start coming when the priest, the younger priest, is in his room and the cross turns upside down on its own a couple times. Mm-hmm. And he made a point of saying, this is sort of where it all starts going south from here, so that we can hold the attention of everybody.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's kind of a good build up too, because like as you're watching it, you know, it's kind of like a roller coaster. You're building up, and then the crosses start to turn, stuff starts happening. You're like, okay, you know, I think as an audience too, you're like, yes, shit's about to get that. It's about to get real.
Yeah. It's putting you at the edge of your seat, and you just want, you're waiting, and it's telling you all the backstory and leading you up to it, which I think is good. And the way, you know, from that cross turning around, it does get a lot worse from there.
Let's talk about Isabella Scorupco.
Dude, she's hot. Yeah. The main female lead. Sarah was her name in the movie.
Yeah.
She was just throwing that brassy, sassy 1940s poon all at the
preacher. Dude, I know.
Oh, it was everywhere.
With those bangs and everything. Oh, man.
I even got a little excited when she's possessed and humping him. I'm like, damn.
Yeah.
I'd probably do it if I was him.
Yeah.
We already went through that you would knock the dust off of a frozen possessed person.
That's true. That's true. If she was frozen in a some contorted manner on my floor, that's still fair game.
Yeah.
She's on your floor.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if I've seen her in movies. I mean, she looks very familiar, but I don't know if I've.
Well, they said
her.
This was her biggest project to date. I don't know what she's done after this, but yeah.
And she said she was fine with you know, being possessed, and obviously we find out that she is the one that is possessed the whole time. But they, you know, they tell us they wait to tell us at the very end of the movie.
Yeah, you think it's the boy for the longest time.
You think it's the little boy, and it ends up being her.
That calculating bitch.
I know. God damn it.
I mean, come to find out, it's she's possessed literally the entire movie, because he finally sees that wedding picture of her and the fuck you say his name? Barusi?
The first doctor that went
the
crazy.
The archaeologist that was there and went crazy.
Yeah.
Was married to her, and she never tells Marin that. So
that stitched the swastika in his chest. And
not Baruzzi, it's Bessian.
Yeah, Bessian. And
and he told her ass to wait in the car. He's just going to go in there for 5 minutes, and then there she had to come.
Right?
Yep. Gosh. Unbelievable.
Bitches always be tripping.
You got to keep your bitch on a leash, okay?
Sorry, ladies. Sorry. I feel like I have to put the disclaimer in there because I have to tell this brief story real quick. Someone,
oh shit, there we go. Danny's going to go off topic.
Oh, yep.
Someone,
God dang it.
So some girl, she, won Horror Freak of the Week a couple weeks ago for one of her memes. I forgot your name. Sorry if you're listening, but, it was turn to
I forgot.
Anyways,
I can look it up.
But she made this cool meme with Texas Chainsaw Next Generation, and it had Matthew McConaughey like holding Renee Zellweger's face all crazy like, and then it said, when he's crazy and you want to leave, but the dick is bomb as fuck. So I posted it. I was like, that's funny shit. So. And but then I got like a message or a comment from some other girl who was like, I saw your sexist post and you've lost a fan, unfollowed. I was like, Jesus.
Oh, no, that's not, that's, it's not, no. It's
so,
not,
yeah, good. It was, so I have to put the disclaimer in there now. Sorry, ladies, we're not sexist.
Not at all.
That was made by a woman, and then I reposted it, and then a woman said we were sexist, so sorry.
Yeah, so we can say whatever we want now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sexist pigs.
Anyways, I just had to share that.
Moving we didn't on. Want you as a fan anyway.
Yeah, what the fuck?
You know what? We're tearing your membership up.
Yeah.
You're fired. You're not quitting.
No more membership for you, dang it.
And you're blocked, too, for when we start to review Bridges of Madison County or some other bullshit.
Yeah, before long, we're gonna have cult classic romantic comedy show.
Yeah, and you're not gonna get to listen to any of the thousands of Sandra Bullock movies that I'll be forced to review.
Yeah, and we're gonna start with Sleepless in Seattle,
and she's gonna want to get back on because that's her favorite movie.
Don't knock Meg Ryan.
I love Meg Ryan and Tom Hanks, of course.
Okay. Anyways,
so like what we were saying, Sleepless in Seattle. Yeah. Is...
No.
It's a lot like anyways, Exorcist the beginning.
Yeah, it's exactly like Exorcist the
it
beginning.
It is. There's an old guy and a girl, and she's got issues.
Yeah.
You know. That's about it. That's about all I got.
So this movie starred Alan Ford, who was the...
Oh, yeah. He was awesome.
He was the guy with the bubbly face that that was super racist and wanted to rape Sarah.
The older archaeologist guy.
With the very sick British accent.
His teeth were so fucked too. My god.
But
he also played a Brick Top in Snatch.
Yeah, so that was next point. Renny actually saw him in Snatch and then requested him for this role. So how cool is that?
He was perfect for this role. He really rocked it.
I mean, he did. He nailed it in Snatch. And then I do see that character of Bricktop playing the character in The Exorcist in this movie. So that was definitely what he did.
I was just wanting him to just go right into it. A pig can strip a human corpse.
Yeah, that would have... I could totally see it. Yeah. So yeah, I just had to put that in there. Saw him in Snatch. Requested him for the movie. Another interesting thing that you may or may not, it's harder to see in this movie, but at least two times you see that white demon Captain Howdy face in the background.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And one of them I had no idea.
You see it in the first Exorcist.
Yeah, one of them I would not have seen at all, except for Renny Harlin was like, oh, and there you see there you see the face.
You see the face.
It's literally, so he's in... Father Marin is in his room. This is a little bit earlier on in the movie. And it's sort of when he has the first flashback of him, of the soldier shooting that little girl in the head. And he freaks out and throws some shit. And then he runs into his own mirror and it cracks. And like right when the mirror cracks, if you look in the crack, you can see the face. Like instantly. It's just really right there and gone. You have to really look close for it.
The Captain Howdy like white face with black and red.
But they did change it. It's a little different. Yeah. And you can see it more clear towards the end of the movie when he's in the cave and with Sarah possessed. And he's like walking up to her. And then you see the face over her like left shoulder in the background real quick.
I thought it was over his left
shoulder.
Oh, maybe
it is over his shoulder. She's coming up to him.
She's coming to him and he grabs the kid.
And then it's over his left.
And it's over his left shoulder. Yeah. You can see the Captain Howdy ghost face again.
Yeah. So.
And see, I think Renny did that just for the fans. You know, it's nice because he did put some like little Easter eggs in there.
Yeah. Well, he did. He admitted it. You know, this was a theme throughout the first Exorcist. We thought we would include it here too.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, I mean, he was probably still all jacked up from Deep Blue Sea, and they just wouldn't let him put sharks in the desert. I think this movie really needs sharks. Or a really great 80s montage song. Did you ever see Dream Master? You
know? Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah. I did that one, too. I did that one, too. That was really great.
I just basically walk around like I'm in my own montage. You know, just like, exorcism. And that was when his cinematographer buddy's like, look, we're friends, but...
Yeah. We can't go that direction.
Let me distract you with this Dutch angle. Look, yeah. Look at that. Look, go over there. Go to craft services. Go. You're fine.
Yeah.
Holy Mother Mary of God.
What is that sound?
What the fuck is that?
Oh my God. I'm gonna cry.
Feels like someone's drilling on my teeth with a fucking dentist drill.
Oh, that's what happened to me yesterday. Oh, what does that mean?
That means it's the horror halftime. This is where we tell you to do something, and if you do it and we like it, we give you free shit.
How's like that? Actual...
Sounds a lot like prostitution.
That's exactly
that's true.
What it is.
we just can't train. We can't exchange money. Yeah. But.
We can give you a T-shirt.
Yeah, there you go. That's exactly what we can do.
We're gonna make. We're gonna put a new T-shirt in the horror store. It's gonna say, "I slept with the Blood Brothers."
Hell yeah!
Rob O'Neill watched.
It just have an outline of the exorcism of Emily Rose, all contorted.
Oh yeah, dude!
I slept with the Blood Brothers, and I wasn't even aware of it.
Yeah, that was the best sex position I've ever done.
All right, well,
do we have a horror freak of the week?
Actually, what I was just gonna inform everyone is this horror halftime is going to prove how lazy we are here at Cult Classic Horror.
Oh man, what happened?
We are going to further extend the horror halftime from the Exorcist 2.
From the worst movies of all time.
Yeah, exactly. Because we're
horror movies.
Because we're almost done with this segment anyways. So we're going to extend it to the next episode, and then we'll announce a couple winners on the next episode. And on that horror halftime. And then we probably won't assign anything then, and then we'll just wait till Halloween starts for the next horror halftime assignment.
Yeah.
So everyone, if you're not don't know what the fuck I'm talking about, for the episode for Exorcist 2, we put a post on our page. It says, name a movie worse than The Exorcist 2 in the comments. And if whoever we agree with the most, we'll get some free shit. But I know you feel cheated because we usually do one a week. So we're going to pick like two winners.
Yeah, I was going to say we should at least pick two or three winners.
We'll pick two or three winners.
Yeah.
And we'll announce them on the horror halftime next week for the last Exorcist episode.
Since it wraps up the series.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So go find that post on our Facebook page, facebook.com/cultclassichorror. Put in what you think is the worst movie, The Exorcist 2, The Heretic. And then if you win, we'll give you some free shit. And also the reason I'm sort of postponing it is because we're getting an Exorcist shirt made right now, and that's what I want to give away. And so it's not ready yet. So
yeah.
Chill out.
So
okay.
you
can't have the one where she's masturbating with a cross because people just can't wear that.
I know,
man.
It's too late.
I was joking.
Don't worry. I actually thought about that and I said, nope, you can't wear that one in public.
So it's one you can wear in public. It's still a classic shot.
All right. That concludes the horror halftime. And we will move on.
Let's move back into this. Act 2 of the Cult Classic Horror.
Yes.
Show.
All right, back into some cool, nifty, neat notes here.
You didn't talk about the tent. I was going to talk about that, too.
Yeah, that's next on the notes.
Well, you skipped down to this one.
What? Oh, I skip notes a lot, then I go back.
Anyways, I forgot my notebook, so I'm reading Danny's because I forgot mine. That's how lazy I am. I just forgot it because I didn't have my car today. But anyway, so the tent that they have there on the site in Africa... quote unquote, they rented a tent.
Well, it's specifically Bastion's tent.
Bastion's tent.
Because the general has his own tent that's not fucked up. But yeah.
Yeah, but then they have the one.
So Father Marin goes to check out Bastion's tent.
Yeah, Bastion's, which is just
finds all those crazy
archaeologist. Yeah,
he has all those crazy pictures in there that he wrote when he went crazy.
Pazuzu.
I'm trying to let you tell this note. But I keep having to correct you. But you can go ahead.
Try again. The way you wrote it down, it just doesn't really make sense to me. So
he's learning, Rob. I'm trying to let him take.
So
I
wrote it down the way I would have read it. But so Bastion's tent. Father Marin goes in there and he sees all these you know paintings and drawings and sketches and stuff. And obviously he finds out he's crazy.
Just nothing but tits and cocks. All
exactly.
Over the walls.
Everywhere.
Which makes him crazy. But you can see that the tent is in like shreds. It's not you can see the roof. There's like lights popping through all these holes. That looks like someone took scissors to it. So they actually did tear up the tent to make it look that way. And it was a rented tent, and they weren't supposed to do anything to it. But Renny Harlin's like, you know what? This does not look right. We need to put some holes in it. So just go in there and tear it up.
Just imagine a fucking shark ate the tent.
Exactly.
I don't understand why you... You know what? I'm going... Stellan, come here. You were... Yes, he was eaten by a shark. I want the tent...
Yes.
To look like when... Has anybody seen Deep Blue... Samuel L. Jackson was in that
movie. Yeah.
He was.
Was it LL Cool J in that too? No,
yes,
that was...
there too, and he had a song, Head Like a Shark's Fin. Fuck all
was
you.
Wasn't Jessica
fuck
Alba
every single one
movie?
Of you guys. I don't want to even be in... It's supposed to be Africa. And fuck Paul Schrader. This is bullshit.
I bet you that's exactly what he said.
What females were in Deep Blue Sea? I thought maybe... I'm thinking Jessica Alba, but I don't think that's right.
No, but she did look... It was like a Jessica Alba knockoff.
Oh, man. I haven't seen that in so long. Anyways.
So, anyways, yeah. Anyways, he said...
Well, fuck Halloween. We'll just do...
Deep Blue Sea!
Let's just go do Deep Blue Sea, and then we'll move on to Jaws and all those other good ones.
I'm ready for Jaws.
No,
anyway,
we can't skip Halloween. I'm ready for a dose of titties.
Yeah, we need that.
And happy titties.
Yeah.
They're stoned and drunk, and they're all... bouncing, and they haven't been run down by life and children and everything else.
That's true.
Go ahead and talk about the tent. I'm just gonna back and reflect.
Talk about my pants tent.
So yeah, I got a pants tent right now. So anyways, Renny said, you know what? We'll sacrifice some camels or something, and we could rip up the tent. So
well, hold
that's
on.
All right.
That came out wrong.
Sacrifice a camel or two.
We won't use a camel. We'll make a budget cut by not using a camel.
No, they're actually sacrificing camels and killing them.
No. I believe it. I'm siding with Scotty on this.
God bless you.
All right, we let Scotty do his note. We let him do his note. Let's move on.
New horror halftime. If you can find proof of animal sacrifice. During the filming
what I mean,
of this movie.
Yeah. What I meant is giving up a camel or two.
Yes.
Not to use. Ah. The wretched camels.
So apparently, we already talked about the CGI hyenas. Apparently they tried to use real hyenas, but they were just untrainable and wouldn't do shit. So there's that.
So I've never tried to work with... sharks to do whatever the fuck I asked them to.
Yeah. But the hyenas,
You're fucking spotted dogs... Over there, whatever they are, they're not doing shit.
Uh-huh.
Get some sharks in here. There's a well, isn't there? The shark could come up out of the well.
Oh my God!
Instead of the hyena.
They figured it out.
And they said they were going to use real flies too, but they would have not.
Yeah, no.
Been able to show up.
If you can't train a fucking dog, I don't think you can train a fly.
And this is what Renny said on the commentary. This is what he says in the commentary. He says. The fly wrangler.
Renny's sitting over there blowing at flies with a straw.
Yeah.
Go to the right.
Go. Go. He's 5 hours later.
He says, the fly wrangler recommended that we use CG flies because normal flies won't do what you want them to. I'm like, who the fuck is a fly wrangler?
Well, what kind of a shit fly wrangler even? You're selling your own job out?
Yeah,
like, I know.
Well, first of all,
I'm a professional fly wrangler, but I'm telling you, I suck at what I do. You just need to go visit my cousin.
Yeah.
He does CGI flies.
Like, who's the fly wrangler? Is that just like the homeless guy that was outside? I mean, who gets that job?
Wrangler. If I can get a license in fly wrangling, I'm changing my Facebook profile.
I mean,
yeah.
you could probably start on this trip with your one pair of underwear by wrangling a whole shitload of them.
they should have used cockroaches like in Creepshow, and that would have been easy, you know. Because you can't fake. You can't. You couldn't see CJ cockroaches.
I need to find Renny Harlin on Twitter. Like, for any fly wrangling you need, you just come see me, okay?
Yeah. I won't sell out and tell you to do CGI flies.
Oh, my God. That is hilarious.
So anyways, also, Renny, this is a little creepy. So the little kid who's in it, the little black boy, and I forgot his name. But
I got his name.
Oh, you did. Oh, okay. Scotty's getting his name. He said, this is what Renny said, his favorite doll was a Britney Spears doll that I gave him.
Could you imagine, like, a 7 foot tall Norwegian has a Britney Spears doll, like, in his fucking glove box.
Yeah.
It's like, hold on, I have very, no, it's not a shark, I promise, I've given all those away. Here's my Britney Spears doll to you.
All right, Remy Sweeney, who played Joseph.
Remy Sweeney played Joseph, and his favorite doll was a Britney Spears doll, which Renny Harlin gave him. So that's not creepy at all.
They should have made a movie about that shit. That would have been amazing.
Oh, man.
We have the Harry Potter janitor in this movie, too, that played
that's true.
Father Gionetti.
Yeah.
David Bradley.
That's all I know him as, the Harry Potter janitor.
Yep. I'm like, who's that guy? I recognize him. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah, the janitor in Harry Potter. So he was one of the fathers, which is pretty cool.
Yep. Another thing that I would never guessed wasn't on location was the asylum where they go in to see Bessian and he slits his own throat and he has the swastika carved in his chest. They low on budget, so they just used the hallway of the studio and put beds in it. So that's what that whole ward is there. And then the actual room of Bessian's is built. It's a built-on room to the hallway that they constructed for that scene. But so yeah, I mean, it looks like a real asylum. When they are outside of the asylum, that is actually on location outside of, I think it was a hotel in Rome. It could have been like a library too. I sort of forgot the exact. But another thing when they're outside is you can actually, specifically in that scene, you can really see their breath when they talk to each other.
Yeah.
And that's because filming went into wintertime there, and it wasn't really supposed to be wintertime, and they're supposed to be in Africa, and they're not really dressed for it, but you can definitely see their breath the whole time. And so Renny just said, maybe the fans will just chalk that off to the evil spirit is coming, is around, and they'll think we meant to do it.
Because every time the evil spirit's around, it gets cold. Yeah. Extremely cold. Which it happens at the very end when he goes into the church, and it's absolutely freezing, and then you know that the Sarah is going to pop out at any moment.
Yeah.
Which, I don't want to jump there, but what did you guys think of the possessed Sarah, her makeup and everything? I thought it was good, but I mean, nothing's going to beat the first one, I don't think. Because the little girl is just creepier, I guess. But I thought it was still good. She was creepy, for sure, with the green eyes.
I mean, it's hard, because, I mean, like, Sarah with makeup is still doable. She's got great legs.
Oh, I know, man.
Yeah, you can't ignore it. Oh, dude, she had great, fucking great possessed cleavage.
Oh, yeah,
and
dude.
I know you're going to finish watching it tonight, Rob, but if you don't...
I remember it.
You remember that? Yeah. She, like, unbuttons her shirt a couple buttons and, like, you know, pulls out her cleavage, and I was like, damn.
Yeah. Or when she's up on the cross with little Joseph, and she flips down, and, you know, and you see her cleavage there, too, when she
but
flips her
head. But not as much, because she's all, like, digital there.
Yeah. And then she crawls on the wall like a monkey. That was pretty freaky.
No, but she still had it going. Even in the digital, they're like, no, they need to be fuller.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Renny's like, I want them to be the smoothness of a shock.
Yep. He wanted to get an attractive girl, but one that would do it. And
is there any way we could make her look more like a shock?
Yeah. What if her skin, because of her being possessed, was, I don't know, sandpaper. Shut the fuck up, Renny. We're done with this. Okay. Yeah. Somebody get him out of my. It's a fucking shark. As he just gets escorted.
We need Paul Schrader over here. God damn.
Where's
it.
Paul?
Shut
Where's
up, Renny.
Paul, we need him.
I've fucked a shark before.
You don't know. I've seen things.
Oh, man.
Okay. So speaking of Renny, during the filming, he was hit by a car.
Yeah, and it the timing was perfect. He was hit by a car. I mean, the timing's never perfect when you're hit by a car, but he was hit by a car and had to be in the hospital for 2 weeks straight But it just so happened to be the 2 week break they took for holiday, for the Christmas.
Over Christmas and New Year's. And so he was
so he said he literally was in the hospital for 2 weeks, got up out of the hospital bed, they put him on crutches, they released him from the hospital and took him straight back to the set. So they didn't miss a day, but he didn't get to do anything for Christmas or New Year's.
And he was on crutches for the rest of the shoot.
Yeah.
Which that would suck.
Yeah.
Made it fun.
That was when they all went in there and got rid of all the shark stuff.
Yeah. Like, finally, clear all the Stark stuff out.
He came back out. I was like, where are the tanks?
They went into his trailer, and it was basically a shrine to sharks.
It was like...
Nobody's going to believe these sharks are just swimming in the sand. Somebody has removed all of the tanks.
It was like Baosin with all the pictures of Pazuzu. It was sharks for Renny. Yeah.
It's like Scotty's shrine in his room to Corey Feldman.
Yeah, yep, exactly.
Oh, my God.
That's supposed to tell, everyone.
I had to watch that Corey Feldman dance routine. Somebody sent it to me.
Oh, Lord. Wasn't he recently? That was recent, right? Wasn't he?
Yeah, it was recent. And who is his agent or publicist that let him go with that shit?
Someone posted it and said, like, said it's not quite on par with fucking what's the guy from Back to the Future who freaked out on his when he was on what the fuck is that actor's name? He plays Marty's dad back in the day.
Oh yeah.
Oh.
Remember when he
George McFly?
Yeah, he totally. It was on the tip of my tongue. Crispin Glover.
Crispin Glover, yeah, he was in Friday the 13th Part 5.
That's right.
That's why we knew him.
And then
he
totally. Freaked out at his interview. So I heard it wasn't on par with that, or maybe not even on par with like Charlie Sheen, but it was pretty bad.
This man went out there dressed as Michael Jackson with like a Jerry curl and moved and gyrated like he was getting electroshock therapy on stage while trying to sing.
Oh, wow.
Dude, you need to send that to me for sure.
Someone was like, the song wasn't that bad.
Oh my God.
I probably don't want to see it, but it's something that I need to see just because I just need to see it.
Yeah.
It is so, so bad.
Oh man.
Does he have a spray tan in it too?
I think he's permanently spray tan. But
oh my God.
The only thing that would have made it better was a shark.
Of course.
Renny was in the background. Where's the fucking sharks?
This just sucks. We need sharks.
All right, I'm gonna suck us back in.
Yes, let's go. Shark us back
sorry,
in.
Sorry. So we already talked about how this was filmed in studio. So all these sets were basically lightweight and made out of fiberglass. And Renny Harlin talked about how great the sound team did. Because you'll notice things like when Father Marin is opening that tomb and he's really struggling to open it, and there's this big sound when he opens it. And in reality, it's just this fiberglass lid that he could easily tap open, you know. But so they had to go in with sound and make all these noises: heavy doors opening, the tomb top opening, any kind of rocks or anything like that. So knowing that and watching it, I think they did a pretty good job with that.
Yeah.
I hear rustling. Is
yeah.
he going to get his Corey Feldman like life size cutout?
I'm almost there.
That was me turning the page on my notes.
Stellan Skarsgård plays
Stellan.
Stellan Skarsgård. He plays Marin in this. He plays Marin in
Dominion.
Is he also the priest in Emily Rose, or is that Tom Wilkinson?
I think that's Tom Wilkinson.
Okay.
Look it up.
Yeah, because Tom Wilkinson doesn't have any scars from the shark attack.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
That's how you can tell him apart.
That's how I know.
And he's not friends.
I'm not giving up on the shark thing.
We're just going to bleed that one dry. Like LL Cool J.
But I did like Stellan Skarsgård, actually. I think he looked the role.
Yeah.
And he acted the role. Like he looked like an old archaeologist. I thought he did really. I think he actually enjoyed the role. I think he did a great job.
Yeah, I do too. And he's sort of a younger guy there too. I mean, he's looking older these days. But
yeah.
Another cool, just cool random things is the guy who did the God, was it... or maybe it was the cinematographer. No, wait. Whoever did the lights. Or maybe it was the cinematographer we already talked about. Vittorio, that has it set up this way. He would go to these shoots ahead of time, set up all the lighting. Now, for those of you that don't like work in film or know anything about it, usually you'll set up the lights for a scene or for...
Is that a stab at me?
No, not you.
Okay. I see how it is. You know, I'm gonna make my own fucking shark movie, and nobody's invited.
No, so we
just gonna be me in a bathtub.
Hey, what about
the toy shark? With the toy shark.
I'll bring my Corey Feldman blow up doll.
Well, then fine. Scotty's invited.
Thank you.
I bet you could get Corey Feldman himself for cheaper than you could get his blow up doll.
I'm trying to make a good movie, damn it.
But anyways, when you set up lighting, you usually do it like per shot. If you're getting a shot of somebody, an over the shoulder shot, they gotta do the whole lighting, and then you get the other angle, they gotta redo the whole lighting from the other side. Well, apparently Vittorio would go and he'd have the whole thing set up on dimmers so that there would be lights from every angle already. You would dim out the ones you don't need or adjust the dim on them. Do the shot, switch angles, do the shot, and it would just, the shooting would go much faster. Of course, the setup took a lot more time, but Renny just commented how he'd never worked with that before, and no one he's ever worked with has ever done that. So I thought that was a cool little fact.
I think they had some great people on this. I mean, that's what really surprised me was that it had like 11% on Rotten Tomatoes.
I know,
This was a good movie.
Yeah. I liked it, man.
And when I saw it in theaters, I definitely left there spooked. I was like, God. Yeah. And especially, you know, there, like you said, it's not psychological. There's a lot of action in it, so it really did keep you at the edge of your seat, which I'm not saying the psychological ones don't. But, you know, like when the light goes out in the cave and you know something's going to happen, and sure enough, you know, her face is right there. And just like the upside down cross and all that. I mean, there's some spooky parts in it. Which I don't think it got credit, damn it. No, we're giving it credit right now.
Yeah, I'm almost at the end of these notes where I just follow through the movie, but...
just a big illustration of a shark at the end of it.
Yeah, basically. we'll keep going with the shark. We'll keep going.
I'm just saying, that's just what I got right now.
So we already talked about the ripped tent, the other tent, the general's tent. That was a cool thing. There's just a shitload of people shaking the tent to make it windy, and then a fan blowing dust at the opening there. So no tricks going on there. And then that's the scene where the butterflies come to life and he shoots himself in the mouth.
That was a little bit of an overreaction to butterflies.
I know, man. I was thinking the exact same thing. Like, while I was watching that in my head, I was thinking, if I saw these butterflies coming to life, and, like, I'd probably assess the situation for a while first. Like, my mental situation, or maybe I have, like, powers now or something like that. Maybe this would be a good thing, you know? Maybe, like, what's going on here? I wouldn't just ultimately go to, I'm going to kill myself.
But then
it just must be typical British.
Yeah.
Oh my God, my prize collection is ruined. I shall just take my own life now.
I think it was more the he was pinning the butterfly, and then all of a sudden he wipes blood on his forehead, and he sees a dead crow or a raven.
Yeah.
I think it was more like, holy shit, and then the butterfly. So that just, and obviously he has some kind of spirit. Something's going on with him from square one.
I think Pazuzu is sort of controlling some of this. So, but he, you know, right before he shoots himself, that butterfly comes out of his mouth. And I guess the way they shot that, because it looks fairly real. I mean, you have these CGI hyenas, you have all this, and then you have this thing that looks pretty good. But they had like an object that they pulled out of his mouth. And then they just took that and replaced it, CGI'd in a butterfly. So that's why you get the real lip movement, because they actually pulled something out of it, but then they replaced it. But I thought they did a great job with that. It looked pretty real to me.
No, I thought it looked real too, but they probably went to the fly wrangler and they're like, well, can you do butterflies? He's like, yeah, you know.
Come on.
Butterflies are tricky.
Yeah, butterflies are tricky. Flies, you know, come on now.
Yeah.
Just get your straw out. We can start blowing them around.
The that whole battle scene at the end where he's trying to get to the church and they're shooting back and forth, that was all filmed on a soundstage indoors. So that's pretty crazy to think of. You have these massive fans blowing dust around, and they must have brought in tons of dirt to act as the floor, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And just the lengths they go to. And even this considered a small budget, but $50 million, Jesus, that's a lot. And that's a lot of shit to do.
Yeah.
For a soundstage.
And
it's hard to believe they filmed all this in a studio.
Yeah. So, that's what I thought, man. I mean, you just think it'd be so much easier to go outside to film a battle scene in a dust storm.
Yeah.
But we could be totally wrong. I mean, you can't control the wind outside. I guess the fans would have to be even bigger to have that big of an impact outdoors. So maybe it was easier just to indoor it. I don't know.
Well, the same thing goes with the church. They built that. It was all clean inside, but then they blew dust in there and stuff too. Yep. So.
Yeah, that whole church was a soundstage. I mean, the whole fucking cave scene was in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's just insane. Like, you have these huge cave walls and everything. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I wonder how much of the budget just went into that when they could have just, like,
gone to a cave.
They could have just bought some plane tickets and just were like, I mean, I think you're flying all the way to Rome. Why don't you just fly to Africa or, you know, somewhere?
Well, they did spend $30 million on a ripped up tent, too. So that took a lot of the budget.
$30 million?
Yep. No. I was joking. No, but Renny, a lot of people did say this was graphic, that there was, which I loved, you know, some people liked it, and some people that didn't like it, thought there was too much blood, too graphic, but Renny Harlin really wanted it to get that R rating and show how it really would be like, you know, in the real wartime and what it would look like back then.
Yeah, he talked about not wanting to downplay a person getting stabbed or a person getting shot. He's like, this is what it would actually look like. I don't want to soften it up just because people are going to think it's too gory.
After you said that, I noticed, like, I'm like, oh yeah, there's some good bloody shots in this, like axe to the head. And,
yeah.
And of course, at the very end, when they go to war, that's the demon, you know, overtaking them and they making them fight with each other. That's where you see a lot of it there too. But yeah, I thought it was pretty, the graphics were good too.
Another interesting little thing we just mentioned how the inside of the cave was studio, where she's running down that hallway at the end, then his words are like punching her, basically.
Mike Tyson 1-2 punch.
she's actually on a treadmill with a green screen behind her.
They're filming her that way.
So I thought that was funny.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
And then of course the hyena scene.
Yeah.
Oh, I remember seeing that one in theaters and just cringing the whole time, like, oh my God.
Yeah. He's ripping the boy apart. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
That's some rough shit.
Yeah,
I still don't trust the dogs in my house.
Yeah, that end scene when Father Marin finally gets the demon out of her, and it's like Mike Tyson punched her. It was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was all right. I mean, it was a little cheesy, but
it gets the point across. Like, boom! Like, he's yelling, and she's running down this cave corridor and on a treadmill.
Rob, you just need to watch Lion King like 10 times so that you see some friendly hyenas. They're not that friendly, but they're not like tearing people apart either.
I don't trust them.
Ed and Shinzi.
You can't even wrangle them.
No, yeah. God.
We need to get the fly wrangler back in here.
That's, I just have a feeling that anyone who wrangles anything in Rome is just lazy as fuck, because they must have been told that by everybody. Oh, CGI the hyenas, you can't, they won't listen to you. Oh, CGI the flies. Oh, CGI the butterflies.
Mm-hmm.
They have a bunch of lazy ass wranglers.
Renny's trying to look up the bird wrangler from Nightmare 2.
Yeah. Oh God, yeah.
He was really good. I remember he was really good.
Yeah, really good.
You put it on a stick and put it
down.
You're
blowing my mind.
Yeah, they could have just tied a bunch of dead flies to a stick with fishing line and had people bob them up and down.
Dude, yeah, that's what they should have done. Dead flies on fishing line.
So the last shot of the movie where they're in front of the Vatican. They did that pretty interesting. So they They went early in the morning. They took a big picture of the front of the Vatican. Of course, in 2005, when they filmed this, the Vatican is, you know, there's security fences everywhere. There's checkpoints. There's things
people
like that.
All over the place.
So I think they got early enough to not have really any people, but they had to digitally remove the fences and everything. And then, so that is actually what's called a plate in the background. It's not the real Vatican that he's walking up to. It's a picture where they digitally removed all that shit, and they call it a plate. It's like a big old picture they put in digitally there. So I thought that was pretty interesting.
Yeah. It looks pretty. It looked pretty real too. And obviously, we see Father Marin going back to his faith, and he's ready to kick some ass now in the next one. Yep. Dominion.
Well, that's all my notes. Yeah, what'd I miss?
The only thing that comes to mind is sharks.
Yeah,
sharks.
Too,
God damn.
I didn't see any sharks in the damn movie. That's what we missed.
Can you hear my neighbor mowing his lawn? Here, be really quiet.
Throw a rock at him.
You probably can't hear it.
You probably can't, actually.
I think I hear a little bit of a hum.
Oh, yeah. That's, I'm getting a hummer right now.
I'm kind of depressed we won't see any sharks in Dominion because Renny Harlin has nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
But that's all right.
Oh, well.
Well, I thought it was a good movie. I really enjoyed it. I mean, the hyena scene was in... it's still... Like, I'm not looking forward to watching it again.
Yeah. And for them...
It messed me up really bad.
And for them being CGI hyenas, it actually doesn't look that bad. Like, it... I mean... Granted, it is obviously CGI. They don't look... They're very obviously CGI. But they're not super-duper horrible CGI hyenas.
And it's graphic. It gets the point across. I mean, it scares you, for sure.
Well, I think Renny did good, because there is a lot of CGI, but he did a lot of good practical gore effects and stuff like that, which you know, I don't know why anybody would be complaining that the movie is gory. Like, if you're going to watch The Exorcist... I just think it's people that just don't like Renny Harlin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was saying he kept the possessed Sarah with kind of the crude language and the obscene language as the first one, as Reagan too. So I like how he kept that too. And we were watching commentary, so I don't really remember exactly what.
Yeah, he was nervous about that. Are people going to be offended that she's using foul language, but she's a fucking demon, you know? That's what a demon would say.
Yeah, your mother sucks cocks in hell, right?
She doesn't go suck them at the bus station.
Yeah. That's what they say in the first Exorcist, so that's kind of what they went with for the beginning as well.
Yeah, I mean, she doesn't say exactly that, but
it's along the same lines.
Yeah.
But no, I like the movie. I think Renny Harlin did a good job, because... It's not subtle. You know, the other ones were kind of subtle, but it's because they were in the 70s.
Yeah.
And there's only so much you could do, but they weren't subtle for the 70s.
Yeah.
You know, so in this one, really, I didn't think was that bad. I thought it was really, really well done, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I was happy to watch it again. It was one of those where when we were talking about coming back, I was like, hell yeah, because I was going to watch it anyway. But I thought it was really good. I mean, you know, it wasn't as good as the Shining miniseries or anything like that. But
I still like it.
You mentioned Evil Dead 2 in every podcast. I'm going to find a way to Steven Weber.
You know what? I'm not taking anything away from Steven Weber. It was a good thing on its own. It just does not compare to The Shining. And I just really want to just fucking kill the kid that was in it. That's all.
Yeah.
That's all there is.
Danny just hates children. Because he doesn't like Child's Play because it's a little doll. Yep. He doesn't like the bucktooth hamster child.
Yep. Exactly.
From the Shining
miniseries, yeah. No. I couldn't even focus on the movie because I just was hoping that he would die the whole time. Yeah.
But no, they make sure he lives.
Yeah, he lives.
It's a lot of screen time.
He's not dying.
God,
man.
A lot of up close, chubby cheeked screen time. Screen time.
Cheeks full of spaghetti.
Well, I did like I did like the beginning. I thought it was really good, and it's I don't know what really people wanted from the movie, because the reviews are horrid about this movie. And I was thinking, well, maybe it's because, you know, I went to the theater and saw it, and it was like 11 years ago, and I started I'm like, no, this is a good movie for any time.
Yeah. So I for people that are listening that haven't seen it, I definitely recommend it. And you guys definitely, it's not like The Heretic, like, don't see The Heretic, but this one, yes, you should see it.
Yeah. Well, cool. We'll move on. We'll finish up with Dominion next week, and then we'll get on to Halloween right before Halloween.
Yes. Sounds good.
So yeah, thanks for joining us, you guys. Make sure to check us out at cultclassichorror.com. Click on the horror store. Check out some cool stuff we got there. Follow us on Instagram at Cult Classic Horror, Twitter, Cult Horror Show. And yeah, Rob, thanks for joining us again.
Yeah, man.
Well, no, thanks for having me. Hopefully, schedules will work out. I'll be back next week. And,
yep,
finish her off.
And as many times as needed through Halloween, because I do enjoy it. I love the movies, you know, and I lucked up. I didn't have to do The Heretic.
Yes, but I still got, you did. You lucked out,
man. I still got screwed and watched it, though.
That's right. It was one you had to. Like, I'm going to have to watch this Corey Feldman music video that you just sent me. So it's one of those things I just have to watch, too.
You could do a review on that piece of shit.
Yeah.
It counts as a horror.
Yeah, it counts as a horror.
It's so terrible. I do appreciate coming back on. I enjoy it. I look forward to the next one.
All right, cool. Well, thanks everyone for joining us. We'll catch you guys next week.
Later, guys.
Don't you blame the movies. Movies don't create psychos. Movies make psychos more creative.
Oh, yes. There will be blood.